welcome as the family of God gathers in this little corner of the kingdom to celebrate the resurrection of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Marty Stevens. I'm happy to be here with you today in person or to know that you are joining us online. Pastor Jay and Kat are with our confirmation youth at retreat this weekend, so I'm the substitute. And Jeremy is with his family in Maine, so Melissa is substituting as the director of the choir today, and Judy is substituting as the piano player. So you've got the substitutes in today, but I hope it will be a meaningful worship experience for you. All of you are getting the weekly e-news, because there is a lot of information in there, and I don't want to take time to go over all of it. If you're not getting the e-news, please be in touch with the office, because there really is a lot of information in there. One thing I do want to tell you specifically today is that this is the last Sunday to purchase poinsettias for Christmas Eve for both worship spaces. So make sure you make that happen today online, purchase poinsettias. I understand that we are doing the angel tree this year, our annual angel tree, completely online. And magically, yesterday, angels descended from heaven and landed on that angel tree. So if you're looking for an angel to choose to get a gift for a child in need, go online to the angel tree and do that. We also want you to get involved with blessing bags and hugs and hope for the holiday cards for immigrants in detention, and Advent workshops that start next week at 10 o'clock in the community center. As I said, there's a lot going on, so please look at your e-news to make sure you know how to get involved. We have a mission minute this morning. Please come forward. Hello?
Especially the ladies, I don't need that.
Yes, you do.
I don't think I need this.
I already turned it on. Just speak.
Okay. Good morning, everyone, and especially the ladies who are here and those who may be tuning in at home. Hear ye, hear ye. The Advent brunch is approaching December the 3rd, which is a Saturday. I realize that Saturdays or your sleep-in day, but you get up and come on over here, because we're having the Advent brunch again after several years of not having it. So we want you all to come. Come at 9:30 so that you can meet each other, greet each other, and if you're really inclined, you can have a mimosa. At this point, a yummy breakfast is being planned that we know you're going to like. A musical program is being planned, and we know you're going to like that too. So ladies, be sure to sign up right outside the door. $8 per person, but we need you to sign up. But you can also go to Sign Up Genius, and you can look at the e-news, and I think there's a link there. So I don't know, what you can do is bring your neighbors. If you are fortunate enough to still have your mom, bring her. Bring your daughters. Bring your granddaughters. Bring a good friend. Or bring somebody just so they have a good beginning of Christmas. I really can't think of a better way to start the Christmas season for 2022. Hope to see you. Y'all sign up. Thank you so much.
Please stand. We continue with the brief order for confession and forgiveness. Praise and thanks to God, Creator, Lord, and Companion, eternal source of forgiveness, mercy, and grace. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people. turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Awaken us to the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may receive your forgiveness, confess our sin, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Gracious God, we humbly acknowledge before you and one another that we have turned from your ways and we have struggled with the power of sin by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We turn to you and wish to do better. We trust in your compassion as you promise to forgive us. As we renew our promise to follow Christ as our Lord, uphold us by your Spirit so we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. God is rich in mercy, loves us even when we give in to sin, and makes us alive in union with Christ. By grace, we are made whole. In the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen us with the power of the Holy Spirit, so faithfulness to Christ may be our way of life. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share a sign of God's peace with one another. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this, for all, let us pray to the Lord.
Good morning. Please join me in a responsive reading of Psalm 145. My soul yearns for you, eternal flame of love, longing to reconnect to the great mystery.
Every day I will bless you as I follow the voice of truth. Great are you who call us to childlike wonder for the healing balm of forgiveness.
Each generation must learn anew the efficacy of silence, the wisdom of turning inward. Do you not know that your whole being is encompassed by my love? I am the infinite and the eternal within your soul. Oh, that I might make myself known to you.
Choose love, that you might overcome oppression and blind obedience to false idols. The time is nigh for you to choose, for great is the new dawn that fast approaches.
I call to each of you to open your inner ears, to see with spiritual eyes, and to trust that even amidst the outward chaos, all is working toward the wholeness of humanity. Thus ends the reading.
Reading today comes from Colossians 1. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Please stand for the gospel affirmation.
The Gospel of Luke, the 23rd chapter. Two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with Jesus. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. If he is the Messiah of God, his chosen." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The good news of God for all people. Having microphone issues, but I hope we'll get those resolved shortly. This is First Lutheran November 20th, 2022. Everything else about today is confusing. Let me explain. First, for decades, almost a century, today has been called Christ the King Sunday. But recently, they have decided that we shouldn't call it Christ the King Sunday anymore. That label is too gender specific, using the title for a male monarch. And the label Christ the King is too patriarchal, referring to a male with power over others. So instead, they want to rename today the Reign of Christ Sunday. But honestly, what's the first thing you think of when you hear the Reign of Christ? R-A-I-N, right? I'm not sure the Reign of Christ is any better label. I don't want to have to spell R-E-I-G-N every time I say the Reign of Christ. It's confusing. Second, this is the last Sunday of the church year. So next week, we start a new year. Now, I understand why the church year is laid out this way, starting with Advent and Christmas. But it's confusing. It's not even Thanksgiving yet. We're in November. How can we be talking about a new year? Will there be a ball drop and fireworks somewhere tonight? It's confusing. Third, most of us have no firsthand experience of a king. I mean, we know about other countries that have kings, but we don't really know what it would mean to live under the authority of a king. King? It's confusing. Finally, the text assigned for today describes the crucifixion of Jesus. It's Thanksgiving week. Wouldn't it be better to have a text to talk about all of God's blessings in our lives and sharing that abundance with others? No. We get a text about the crucifixion. Confusing. I said that to start. It's either Christ the King, gender specific and patriarchal, or it's the Reign of Christ, R-E-I-G-N. Today is the last Sunday of the church year, even though it's November. We have no experience of living under a king. Here on Good Friday. It's confusing. But I suppose now that I've pointed out the immense confusion related to today, I'll provide some clarity. I mean, I am standing here in the pulpit, right? I should provide some kind of clarity. So since Jesus was labeled king in the first century, why don't we start with what it meant to be a king in the first century? That the king was the one in charge of the territory. And when I say in charge, I mean in charge, all caps. And you can be sure that the king told everyone all the time that the deity had specifically chosen him to be the king. The king built in the God's favor and on the throne. One obvious sign of the God's favor was for the king to have sons, the more the better, because then there's a greater possibility that at least one of them will survive the inevitable political infighting and be capable of running the kingdom. Of the territory he controls. He needs to ensure that the inhabitants are safe, as they shepherd their flocks and raise their crops. So there needs to be an army to repel the foreign invaders. Oh, and keep the local citizens. The king could make whatever rules he wanted, and people had to obey or face the consequences. And usually those rules involved making sure the resources flowed from the people keeping the flocks and growing crops upward to the king to keep up his palace and his household and the army and all the cronies who did his bidding. For himself. Jesus never claims the title of king for himself. Jesus is only known as king because others label him with that title. Well, that's certainly not like any earthly king that the people were familiar with. Jesus does claim the favor of the deity. Ensure the continuation of the royal dynasty by father and son. Jesus doesn't have any royal sons. Instead, in the kingdom that Jesus rules, each of us is a royal child. God claims and anoints each one of us to be a link in this royal chain of the kingdom. Being assigned to Jesus in this inscription isn't so much a geographic area, but a territory of people, a territory of people known as Jews, a group defined by their religious beliefs and their ethnic heritage. Whoever wrote this inscription meant it as a sarcastic taunt. Some claim this man is the king of the Jews. Like beaten, hanging on a cross, executed for treason. Ha! King of the Jews! Ha! The Romans felt threatened by a man that some claimed were king of the Jews, and so they executed him. And those claims were right. Jesus was the king of the Jews and the Gentiles and the whole world. Salvation offered by Jesus is open to all ethnicities, all belief systems, all people of the world. Jesus, as king, does not close the borders and raise an army to guard them. In fact, anyone who wants to enter this king's territory is welcome with open arms and invited. Sour wine, mocking his condition, and they shout, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." This is a very telling moment in the text because it shows us what their expectations are. If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. Naturally, they expect a king to be first concerned with saving himself. They think a real king would save himself by any means necessary. But what would it mean for Jesus to save himself? Would he call on an army of angels? The Roman soldiers think crucifixion is the worst possible outcome, and they taunt Jesus to save himself. But they misunderstand, don't they, what saving oneself really means. They misunderstand that saving oneself doesn't always have to do with personal saving. Jesus teaches that the way to save your life is to lose it. Jesus teaches that resources should flow outward to others, not upward to those in power. That having two cloaks means there is one available for somebody else who needs it. Jesus teaches that death does not have the final word. The paradox is that we ourselves are saved entirely by grace. And then we demonstrate that salvation by caring for our neighbors, by loving others, and by working for the best interests of others. Jesus doesn't save himself by escaping crucifixion. He continues to hang there. Unlike any king they've ever seen, healing, his attitude of compassion, his acts of love, his obedience to God's mission, even if it killed him. All of his life and mission and purpose is focused in this gruesome crucifixion and glorious resurrection. God saves the whole world by raising. After all, about Christ as our King. Jesus has inaugurated the kingdom of God, and we are all invited to participate in the abundant life that God offers. Salvation offered by Christ our King is open to all who want to believe. We can follow a king like that. We can worship. Dedicate our lives to serve. food. Thank you.